Who's excited to do another panel? Okay, so you guys heard me in the back, right? What we're gonna do is we're gonna let the audience ask questions, and then when the audience asks a question, you guys can just kind of do like a weird eye contact thing at each other and decide who wants to take a stab at it. And then we'll just pass the mic around. No order, no anything. If somebody wants to add, so maybe Lowell answers a question, but maybe Lawrence is going, you know, I got something to add to that, say, just give me the mic. Or just take it with the, you know, the thugged out gangster music. Just share, try to make sure there's some diversity, but if somebody feels, you can always just pass too. Like, if you feel like, hey, that's a better question for somebody, pass it. All right, you guys good? All right, let's start with Phil. Table number one, question number one. Let's get the mic on, actually. The microphone's hot over there.
Hi, Richard Berry. Hi, Richard Berry with Team Bora Bora.
Yeah!
So my question is, how would you be able to get your Shopify store higher in the search rankings and maybe something more than just SEO?
How can you get higher search rankings for your Shopify store, and if you have a little bonus, maybe more than just ranking in an SEO? Anybody want to take a stab? Anybody, anybody, anybody? Lowell?
All right, so this is the easiest way, okay? Coming from an SEO background and stuff like that, first off, don't waste your time doing organic ranking because it'll naturally just happen. And when you start sending traffic to it and you start getting, you know, SEO signals through social media and stuff like that, it just naturally it's going to happen. So you'll actually start ranking for all sorts of things that's relative to your product, and that's what you want to be ranked for, because that's how you're going to get conversions from people naturally finding you. So that's the easiest way for it.
Awesome. And one thing that I've found, you guys can tell me if you found this as well, but if you just launch a website and try to do SEO on it, sometimes it ranks well, sometimes it doesn't. But what I found is Google's putting a lot of heavy weight on things that go viral on Facebook. So if there's a lot of likes, shares, comments on a link, that social media weight goes into the Google algorithm to figure out, hey, Google wants to rank what's popular. So if your posts are going viral on Facebook, it's going to help, right?
Absolutely, yeah. And just that link back coming from those social networks, they're definitely giving power on that. So,
yeah, a lot of people think that social media links don't work because they talk about this thing called Google nofollow. But I found the opposite to be true. I had a website, I had an article I posted on a basic blog that was a trending event. It just happened. Somebody had passed away. And I was running an ad, and it was for the star of Fast and Furious, Paul Walker. And I was running an ad when he had passed away, and that blog post was ranked number one in Google for, like, Paul Walker, you know, whatever it was, Paul Walker dies or whatever it was. And that got something like 15,000 visitors in a single day. I did no SEO, no optimization, anything. All I did was I had the viral post on Facebook, which I boosted with an ad. So if you're looking for an idea besides just ranking a site, Lowell said, let it naturally happen, because as you're running traffic to your site, that's going to make it popular and help it rank. Is that helpful?
Thank you.
Thanks, Lowell, for that. All right, next we have Alicia, right here.
Hi, Anthony Johnson from Australia. My question is to do with, like, if you have a general store and you've got, say, like, four categories of products in the store, you might have something in cosmetics, something in fishing, something in whatever, and you're getting email lists, is coming to you're getting the emails from, or building the list, and then you're saying that, first, how do you integrate the autoresponder into Shopify? Secondly, how do you segment that list? If you're going to send an email out to the guys, you're not going to send one to about cosmetics if the guy's into fishing.
Sure. So the question is, and thank you. And by the way, thanks for coming from Australia.
Thank you.
Nice commitment there. All right. So you heard the question. To kind of recap, one of the things we're going to be teaching at Techademics that is rarely taught anywhere in e-com is really having a strong follow-up, building an email list, doing strong follow-up there. What he's asking is saying, for starters, if you have a general store, maybe you have four completely different product categories, and maybe those are selling like 10,000 buyers, people on each list. Is it smart to kind of segment those, mail those, or really actually at this point, any thoughts you have about email marketing and list segmentation, if anybody wants to take a hit at that?
Yeah, sure. I can take that. So there is an app called Klaviyo, I think it is, which is an email autoresponder that integrates with Shopify. And with that one, you're able to segment your list into, you can tag your email your customers with different tags depending on what they're buying and so on. So you can segment your list into different segments and send out different emails to them.
Okay, so in a very simple method, there's apps in the Shopify App Store that allow you, Klaviyo, for example, you could probably just do a Google or a search in the App Store for autoresponder, but there's apps that will literally will segment your categories of buyers into different email lists and allow you to email directly from them. And do you recommend that as a strategy? Peter, did you have a thought you want to jump on that?
Just the basic autoresponders, they all have Shopify integration as well, like AWeber and MailChimp. MailChimp actually has a e-commerce section for emailing. So when you email your list on MailChimp, you can actually say only people that bought this product or only people that bought these products that have this tag on it. So only like your cosmetic people will see that email. Or you can go a different route and you can be like Walmart, where if Walmart mails you something, they don't remember that you only bought like pet products. You know, they just say, hey, here's a catalog of all of our products. Everything's on sale. Purchase it, you know. So you can, because you're a general store still, so you don't really need to get that specific, right? Because if someone likes like pit bulls, they might still like coffee, right? They might like two things. Or you can go categories on MailChimp. Me personally, I do use MailChimp and AWeber.
Hey, it's Jim Jiminy. Hey, that's a nice mustache. Is that real? Does that come off? It's coming off, Jim. It's coming off. Yeah,
just one thing to add to that with MailChimp or any autoresponder is you actually build a list a lot faster than you think. So the one thing I wish that I would have done better is segment my list right from the beginning, because there's a lot of wasted, you know what I mean? Like, you don't know what niche you may get into, right? So maybe you might really grow in the makeup niche, for example. Now you have an awesome like audience that's already segmented that you can sort of port over or, you know, speak specifically to, right? So.
Wait, we don't have a mic, so it's, we can go back to him if he's going to say it.
No, that was my point. You know, if you actually get these four products going and one of them actually starts really booming, you want to be talking to that list. You want to be kind of, you know, really talking to them.
Here's an interesting thing. Watch this. And I found this to be true. We'll just put it everybody here on the spot. How many people sitting at this roundtable discussion kind of wish, like, in hindsight, kind of wish that they would have had a little bit better of an email follow-up and multiple sales going on in your email if you were to start all over again? Raise your hand if you're here at the panel. Look around. Okay? So real quick, when I ask people that are doing six figures with Shopify, one of the most common things is, man, you know, for whatever reason, I just never really got around to setting up an effective email campaign. Now, in the beginning, don't make that an obstacle that blocks you from getting started. Clearly, they're doing plenty fine without that. But at some point, you really do want to make that effective. So we recognize problems and solutions at Techademics, and that's something we're going to do, is we are going to teach effective email marketing. For example, if this cosmetics thing's going on, you know that you've got an audience of women, you can start to put together some cool print-on-demand items or some cool jewelry items, some cool complimentary items to go along with that and say, hey, you purchased this product, you might be interested in this one, we'll give it to you free plus shipping. Or hey, we'll give you $10 off a coupon to be able to buy this t-shirt. There's lots of effective campaigns. We're going to be teaching those at Tech Weeks as well as the Ecom Incubator in a lot of detail. Next question, we're going to go over to Phil over here in the back.
Oh, hi, Chris. This is Luna from Canada, and I have a few questions. I have somebody actually online watching it live. So this is Diane's question. She's asking you, what excites you about the future of e-commerce?
Let's talk about the future of e-commerce. What excites you? What is something that you're excited about when it comes to where this industry is going and what's happening? Anybody want to take a stab at it? Anybody?
With e-commerce right now, I'm excited about it because I can still push really big numbers, but I'm really only marketing to the US and through Facebook. You know, I haven't even opened up like Pinterest or Instagram yet, and I barely even started going to like Europe or Australia or Canada and other English-speaking countries. So there's still a lot of room to grow, like plentiful room, you know?
Yeah, one thing that's pretty exciting, and even Shopify is doing a good job of this, is with the different sales channels that they're adding. So one of those sales channels is Messenger. So Facebook Messenger it's been around for a little bit, but they're starting to add more automated features to it. You can actually sell through Messenger now. So you can actually add a carousel of all of your products. Basically, you can scroll through. So it's great for really interacting with your customers. And I think more and more of that will happen. I think there's actually a few apps where you can follow up with people who have commented on your post in Facebook. So you're running a post in Facebook for one of your products, people have commented on it. There's actually some apps out there that will let you follow up with those people and start a personal conversation. So I think that's pretty exciting. The whole bot world is pretty, I think there's going to be a lot of powerful features that really enhance that.
Awesome. So there's a couple answers. I'll chime in on this and say one of the things I'm excited about is brought up earlier from email marketing is email marketing. It's exciting to see that I work hand in hand with some of the biggest and best e-com sellers really in the nation, people that have done millions of dollars. And almost none of them have a really effective strategy that they're teaching with email marketing, yet it's just a creative idea. So if e-commerce is getting this far and people are making so much money without even massive email campaigns going, I think that that's going to be huge. For example, in the internet marketing niche, I built an email list that is the make money online list, MMO. I built an email list of 100,000 people that want to make money online. And that list generates anywhere between $1 to $3 per month per subscriber. So a 100,000 person list makes me between $100,000 to $300,000 per month on average in the MMO space. So if we can be the leaders in figuring out how to get a high customer value per subscriber in this space, it's a lot easier to build a 100,000 person list of customers, free plus shipping customers, than it is make money online customers. I was spending, you know, like $3 to $5 per lead to build up that list. Whereas in this space, you know, we were talking the other day, you got like a 100,000 person buyers list. It just happened. It's just kind of like making money that, oh, by the way, I also happen to have this 100,000 person list. Are you kidding? I spent several $100,000 to build mine. So I think that is going to be part of the future is when people realize, wow, free plus shipping offers are really just an entry into the house of opportunity, and now there's literally 100 different things that we can do inside of this house once we put our brains together and start seeing what's working. That's kind of one of the things I think is the future. Let's go to another question with Alicia over here.
I'm Melissa from Scottsdale, Arizona. We talked about this at lunch with the amazing Stephanie Homeyer from Techademic Staff.
Yeah. Yay, Stephanie!
And she has been building on Shopify for a while, so we got talking about that. It intersects with a question that we had at our table about what do you do if a Facebook ads account gets shut down and whatnot. Something I learned from Lawrence Aponte was setting up an ads manager account and all your fan pages through business.facebook.com. And it seems that a lot of people I've talked to didn't even know that existed, just like me, I didn't know that existed. And so in talking to Stephanie, she said that, you know, we surmised, and I want to know what your insight is to this, that maybe they take you much more seriously and approve you maybe faster. Or one of the things I like about it is that everything is all there, all my fan pages, all my stats for my ad manager, everything's all on one page. Maybe speak to the
thoughts on business manager versus a traditional Facebook ads account.
Right, okay. And setting up your fan pages from there.
Okay, so a business, if anybody wants to kind of take a stab, let's talk about when most people get started, especially if they got started a while ago, before business accounts came out, you would set up a Facebook ads account, you start running ads on it. But if something happened to it, then you were stuck with no ads account. Business ads accounts came along, and now you can set up one main ads account and have multiple different things inside of there. Don't worry, don't get overwhelmed. It's actually pretty simple. Does anybody here want to chime in thoughts on business ads accounts, the benefits, pros and cons, or any thoughts on it at all to chime in on this?
So with business ads manager, there's just a lot more features as opposed to just your personal one. You're actually able to add, like if you have virtual assistants, you can add them as an admin so they can, you know, take care of your page. You're able to make multiple ad accounts in case one of your other ones do get banned and you need to run ads from another account. And just Facebook in general is just going to take you more serious as opposed to running ads from your personal.
So the real difference, business ads accounts, you just go to business.facebook.com and you can set up your ads account there, and then you can set up like multiple ads accounts inside of it.
Right.
Pretty simple process. Do you think that's something, is there anybody here, would you recommend that even a beginner go that way?
Yeah.
Okay, so everybody here just said no question, definitely. So when you go to set up your ads account, You can go to business.facebook.com, set up an ads account there. It's a little bit of a different interface, but it's essentially the same. It's essentially the same. And we will teach that at Techademics as well. Now, I got a question. This made me think about it. I want to ask this question to Luda, as long as you don't mind answering it. One of the things that I actually was just bringing up with all this was we talk a lot about business ads and Facebook. And we always talk about Facebook targeting and Facebook everything. One of the cool things about the way you decided to run your store was you were familiar with Instagram. Instagram, you already were on Instagram. You're already doing fashion stuff there. You liked it. You actually chose to run Instagram ads to sell products on your store. So you have a Shopify store, and you're running Instagram ads more than even Facebook ads. Would you talk to a second about what made you decide to do that, and is it easy? Is that something people here should consider, Instagram ads?
Yeah, well, I have two fashion accounts.
Talk a little closer to it.
I have two fashion accounts on Instagram, and I just saw the, I just see the demand. A lot of engagement, you know, and I really know what's in. And I actually started a campaign. I started a Facebook campaign, and I found that my cost per click was a lot higher with Facebook than Instagram. And the click-through rate was a lot lower. So I found that Instagram worked a lot better for me.
So you literally ran both Facebook and Instagram ads at the same time, and you actually found, you split tested, Instagram, you're getting a higher click-through rate and a lower cost per click.
Yeah, so for Facebook, it was $1.20 as opposed to Instagram. Instagram was like 19 cents.
19 cents?
Yeah.
Did anybody catch something there? Her cost per click running Facebook ads to her product was $1.20. Her cost per click on Instagram was 19 cents.
I only do Instagram. I don't run any Facebook campaigns at all.
And then she switched to Instagram and only runs Instagram ads to her store. And her store has done quite well. 30 days you did? 32,000 in sales from Instagram ads in 30 days. And I know we talk a lot about Facebook ads. Now here's the thing. Do you still log into your Facebook ads account to place the Instagram ads?
Yes.
So it's still the same thing. But all you're doing is when you go in...
Selecting Instagram instead of Facebook.
Yeah, so you go in, it's all the same. You go into Facebook, but instead of choosing, I want it to run on the Facebook news feed, there's four options. You choose the one that says Instagram. And it's literally, now what are you running? Are you running a picture? Are you running a video? Are you running a link?
I haven't done video. I want to do video, but just pictures, images. I do carousel ads, so multiple 5 to 6 images.
She does what's called carousel ads, 5 to 6 images. So she's running image ads on Instagram. And what do you think it is that causes it to be successful? When someone's scrolling through the Instagram feed, is it like they just look and see a really cool product and they go, man, I want to click on that?
Well, also there's a lot less kind of, I don't want to say, less ads on Instagram. It's just images. And, you know, with Facebook, the interface, it's just, there's a lot of clutter, a lot of, I don't know, comments. This person liked this image and this person commented on this. Instagram is just images. And it's very hard kind of almost to decipher which is a sponsored ad and which is an actual, you know, account that you're following, perhaps.
Sure, because like she says, Facebook has a lot of noise. Yeah, Facebook's got a lot of noise. There's ads on the side. There's ads in the news feed. There's lots of stuff going on. There's groups. There's pages. There's people. There's friends. There's locations. There's events. Facebook is really like a world.
Busy.
Instagram is just, you're only on your phone. You can use Instagram for your computer. No one does. This is Instagram, thumb. And you can't really decipher the difference between a picture and an ad. So you're capitalizing on the fact that people don't have advertising blindness on Instagram. It looks very native, it looks like a regular picture, and you're actually getting cost per click a lot lower, and it seems to be converting.
Yep, really well.
Anybody appreciate that tip? Okay, where were we? Are we, Phil, your side, let's get on the question.
Hi everyone, Myra from Connecticut, Team Miles Eagers. Question. It has to do with Facebook and Instagram. When you're building out your campaigns and you're doing your $5 budget a day, does it tell you when you have a winner, or do you have to physically go in there every single day and look at the statistics and look at what it's been spent? Is there an app or something that tells you when you have a winner in a campaign, or is something that you have to look at every single day? 1-2 times a day.
Okay, fantastic question. It's a great question. So you're placing ads, and you got money going out. Maybe you have 4 or 5 ads. You're spending money. What metric is it that you're looking for that tells you whether or not that ad is successful? I mean, you look at your Shopify store. You're like, sales are coming from somewhere. You're spending money on these ads, but how do you know which ad is successful? What metric are you looking for, and how often per day are you checking it once per day, twice per day? Or are you like me, where like when I started, I just kept refreshing and going on there all day? You want to take it?
Yeah, sure. I'm not aware of an app that can do that. I go into my Facebook ads account 3 times a day at least, morning and midday and evening, and check the stats. And what I'm looking for is basically how much have I spent on an ad and how much has that ad made me. So basically the Facebook pixel gives me that information, that how much sales every single individual ad have made.
Okay, so if you're taking notes on that, it's not that there's an app that shows you, unless of course if there's a need for one, Techademics would love to create one. But what he's using is called a conversion pixel with Facebook. And if as long as you're using a conversion pixel, what it will say is it will say, when you look at your ads account, it will say, this ad, titled whatever, ad 123, you've spent $5, and your conversion, your cost per conversion is blank. If you've had one conversion, whatever, maybe your cost per conversion is like $5. You have had two, maybe it's $2.50. It's, you have a cost per conversion. So that conversion is when somebody buys something. So you have a way to set this up with Facebook using the Facebook pixel. That's what you use. Does everybody, is that pretty universal? Does everybody here use the Facebook conversion pixel to see if your ads are successful? Is that, yeah? Does anybody have any alternate methods, or is that what you suggest everybody use? Yep? Okay, Facebook conversion pixel. So what about Instagram? Instagram is the same. Here's a cool thing about Instagram. Does anybody know who owns Instagram? Facebook. So Instagram does not have their own advertising platform. If you want to place ads on Instagram, you're still placing the ads on Facebook. You can, when you have ads on Instagram, you can log through and they have insights. You can see how your ads are performing really quickly on Instagram. But you place them all through Facebook. Essentially, Facebook and Instagram are the same thing. They're two different companies owned by the same company. So it's the same exact way. Was that helpful? Okay. Did you want to chime in or?
Yeah, all you have to do really is log into your ads account and then look at the metric. They actually show you all the data. You just set it up, look at purchases to see if you're making sales. And then you can also look at link clicks, you know, to make sure the cost per link is like really cheap. And then for me personally, I only check my ads maybe 2 to 3 times a week, because I used to look at it every single day too, like, you know, 2-3 times a day to make sure, like, oh, am I getting sales? But then after a while, Facebook kind of changed their algorithm to where the pixel has to warm up. So I only really look at it once every 2 to 3 days after I know everything's been seasoned, I got a good amount of data. Because you don't want to, like, log into your account when you only spent $1 and said, oh, I didn't make a sale yet. Oh, turn it off, you know? Like, you got to wait, you know, make sure you spend maybe $10, $15 and then see where the data is coming from. And then you can look at the age groups, the gender, and things like that. So when you want to scale, you know, to only show it to those demographics that are buying your products. You don't need to show it to people that aren't buying it, right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, so in summary, that was a great comment there, is when I first started selling with Facebook ads, I checked it all day long. It's kind of like, imagine if you were buying a stock and you just started, you bought it, you know, I'm going to buy this thing and I'm going to at least hold it for a month or whatever. And imagine if you checked it 5 times a day. It would drive you crazy. Oh my gosh, it's up. You know, we're going to do great. Hey, we should go out and go have a nice dinner tonight. And later on that day it's down. You're like, oh my gosh, you know, we got, let's not save any, you know, kids, no, sorry, you can't have any candy or anything. You know, the stock is down. You're to go on this roller coaster the whole time. That's kind of how Facebook ads are. And what he said was a really, really good idea, which is in the beginning, you're checking it because you're getting familiar with it. But you have to let the ad run long enough to get enough data. Let's say your ad has spent $4 out of the $5 and it hasn't made a single sale. You might think, oh my God, this ad is just flopping. Well, maybe the last dollar was going to get a sale. Or like Peter said, maybe it takes time for the pixel to mature. So maybe day one you don't make any sales, then the second day you make a sale, and then the third day the same ad makes 5 sales. So there is a little, if you can withstand for a few days, Peter recommended 3 days or so, a few days, check it every few days, you actually give the pixel a chance to mature. And I think it's fascinating, roughly how much in revenue are you doing on a daily basis from your store?
I have 5 stores.
5 stores.
So when you add it all up, I think yesterday was $14,000.
$14,000 yesterday from a combination of 5 stores. So, congratulations, that's awesome. $14,000 in a day, and he's only checking his ads every few days. So I think there's some wisdom there. In the beginning, I know you're going to be a junkie. I was. I think we all were. Because you're just like learning. You're like, oh my God, like what are all these reports? You also said one more fascinating thing. When you want to scale, you're not necessarily just looking at the cost of conversion, but you're actually diving in and saying, what age demographic is buying? Is it men? Is it women? What age? What location? You know, when I started selling, I actually started selling to 5 different countries, and believe it or not, my best conversions were coming from just 2 of the 5 countries, and then I created a new ad to just each one of those countries individually, and it started converting way better. So as you start selling, you can look at the data and start to see your buyers, see who they are, and you can start targeting them. Pretty cool. Facebook's awesome. This side of the room, let's do another question.
Hi, I'm Nicole from Chicago. And my question is, my question is, when you have a customer that's buying your free plus shipping and they're buying a regular price item on your store, how when they check out that they're not getting charged the both different shipping, the standard shipping for the regular price item and the shipping for the free?
Okay, I get the question. And actually, this is a very good question as well. I've seen a lot of beginners make a mistake of just not knowing how to set up shipping for free plus shipping. One of the most common mistakes I've seen is people forgetting to set it up right. So someone will come for a free plus shipping offer. If they order one, it's fine. But if they order 2 products, they're only still paying the same shipping rate. So if you're charging $9.95 shipping, I've seen some people set it up where literally someone could come in and buy 5 of that free giveaway, but they're only paying $9.95 in shipping. Oh my gosh, you'd be losing money if that's the case. So you have to set things up. So whoever wants to take a stab, if anybody here has done free plus shipping offers, on a free plus shipping offer, what do you do to make sure the customer's paying a new shipping charge for each one? I know you don't have a computer, so just talk about it. You want to take it?
Yeah, so actually when we first started on Shopify, that's all we did was free plus shipping. We did it for like 90 days straight. So I'm very familiar with the shipping rates. So how I did it personally was, if the item was retail, meaning that I wasn't going to give it away for free, I would weigh the item, no matter if it was a bowling ball or a feather, at 1 pound. And then if it was a promotional item, meaning that I was going to give it away, I would I weigh the item at 0.1 pound. And then you just have to set up rules for each time, for each instance that a customer would buy. So if they bought like 1 retail product and 1 free item, it would essentially weigh 1.1 pounds, and you would just have a certain rate for that. So it kind of gets like long, because you're going to have to set up rules for like almost every instance, but you can have apps that can kind of help it, and you can set like a maximum number of products that can be purchased. So set, you know, a limit of 4.
Let's talk about that for a second, okay? And I know there's a lot of data coming up without sharing a screen. If you're running just a free plus shipping offer, if somebody wants to order more than one of these items, number one, is that a good idea to offer more than one at a time? And number two, what's the right limit? You're saying you want to make sure you put a limit. They can't just order 100 of that item. Is it a good idea to offer more than one at a time for free shipping? And if so, what's a good limit?
Yeah, so when I first started, that was one of my mistakes, that I was only limiting the customers to 1. And I was leaving a lot of money on the table, because I would see the customers would try to order more than 1, and I would have to like cancel the order because I didn't really understand it. But then once I kind of figured out the trick where you, it's just you're gonna get more money. So how I set it up was 1 free item was $7.95, and then 2 free items was $14.95, and then 3 items is $19.95, and 4 items is $24.95. And then each one of those rules is 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, and it just kind of works out if you set up the rules correctly. And so when a customer adds additional free items to the cart, essentially just going to raise your cart value up.
Okay, so trying to keep it as basic as possible, because again, this is a Q&A session, not a screen sharing session, so there's only so much he can actually explain. What he's saying is a great idea he wished he would have done sooner, he did, was instead of saying free plus shipping, limit to 1, he said limit to 4 per customer, and he gave them a slight break if they ordered 2. They get a little bit less per shipping on each individual one. If they ordered 3, it was a little bit less than they ordered 4. So like he said, maybe it's you're still paying shipping on each free item, but it's not double. If you order 2, it's not double. It's a slight discount. So it's kind of an incentive. And what he said was he was leaving a lot of money on the table, because some people come in and they're like, this is free? Now all I got to pay for shipping, I want four of them. And that's actually equivalent to four customers. The same $5 ad got them there, but their cart value was four times as much. So he's willing to offer a little incentive because he still had a great markup on it. So in order to do that, you have to set what's called shipping rules inside of Shopify. And in order to put everybody at ease, at some point, would you or somebody else, would we be willing to do a webinar inside the community, a basic webinar on shipping rules?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Would you guys like that? Basic webinar on shipping rules? So we don't have to get into it here, but if, for those of you that are a little bit more advanced, what he said was item one, he did 0.1. Then if they ordered two, it's 0.2. If they ordered three, it's 0.3. Order four, it's 0.4. So if you understand that, he just kind of gave you the basics of that. Does anybody else want to chime in on it?
There's also an app called the Better Shipping app.
That's actually Better Shipping app.
Yeah, and it just allows you to choose the shipping per product. So that way everything kind of just works out cleanly.
Yeah, so there's the cool thing about Shopify is there's apps in the marketplace that allow you to be able to do things a little bit easier, and there's always new apps being developed. So make sure you check, anytime you're doing something that's like a long task, make sure that you check the Shopify app marketplace to see if there's something to simplify it, or contact Techonomics and give us an app idea. And Chase probably already created it though, you know, so he's on top of it. All right, we have a question. I don't know where we have a question. I'm over there, another question.
Hi, I'm Joy Hartwell, the mom of CJ. We have a niche store, and before it came up with our store, we tried to test some products, and it's a baby niche, so that's something that I want to give away. But the question is, if you're new, and we've tested some products and we're building a new store, is it good to try an app called Credibly to boost sales for product reviews and all? Has anyone used that?
Okay, so let's rephrase this question a little bit to two parts. One, has anybody used an app called Credibly in the App Store? There's hundreds, I think thousands of apps, so number one, has anybody used it? Number two, since we got the question, is there another app or any kind of apps that you might recommend that people at least check out and look at inside the App Store? Maybe a couple app recommendations. So first, has anybody used an app called Credibly?
I haven't used that app. My guess is the app is just something to where customers can review your products, right? Yeah. You don't really need to focus on that if you're just starting out. The main thing you should focus on is just getting the right product to the right traffic. That's it. If you want to go that route to the point where you're kind of building credibility for your store, let's say later in the future, and you want to kind of build out a brand following, what you should do is you should actually have it on your email follow-up just on a month or 2 months in, right? After they buy your product, ask them to send you a picture of them wearing your shirt that they bought or a necklace or something. That way, you know, later down the road, you're going to have a huge collage of all your customers, and you can put that as the review. So you don't need an app for it, right? It's going to help with conversions a lot.
Nice tip.
Last question. Uh-oh. Is it okay if I don't use any funnels? It just so happened that for this particular niche, I don't use any funnels.
Yeah, I'm not using any particular funnels. So I'm sending people directly with my ads to the product page. And I don't even have any type of upsell other than recommended products under that selected product.
You know, let me chime in on that. I remember when Lawrence was in the mastermind and he had this nice little pack of people around him, and Lawrence was showing him this thing. Lawrence is, not to be offensive to your website, I can't even repeat the name of Lawrence's website because of how bad the name was. It's if pronounced wrong, you might actually think that I'm cursing at you right now or actually saying something very vulgar. It didn't matter. And if I showed you the logo, you guys might think that Lawrence has a six-year-old child that did it. And then if you look at his page, it was not a fancy website. The thing was, he didn't care about any of that. Literally. I mean, I'll let him speak to it himself, but all Lawrence was saying was what Peter just said. Lawrence, all he cared about was, I'm getting this product for $2. I'm selling it for whatever, $22, whatever it was. It's just a simple page. Here's the picture. Here's the offer. Buy it. Check out. None of the other stuff even mattered. I mean, the other day we just told a story about somebody who set up a site here ran an ad to it and already has two sales, that got two sales right off the bat on it, and he didn't even fill in the thing that's like, your store description goes here. He forgot to change that. So let's talk about this for a minute, and maybe since I mentioned Lawrence, you can explain, and anybody else can chime in, maybe even Luda, because I know Luda went the direction of making sure her store was the most perfect-looking store in the world, but that wasn't necessarily making more money. You chose a totally opposite approach. And maybe I'm being a little too bad. Maybe you actually thought your store was really good. You know, I don't want to be insulting. But how important is it to have a good store with all the related products and all the SEO optimization and all of the better designs and, you know, and hundreds of products, all that kind of stuff? How important is that versus using the approach that you used?
Yeah, in my opinion, it's not very important. I mean, at the end of the day, you just need to send traffic to your site and just make sure that buy button is working, right? Just go through, that's all. Just make
Hold
sure
on, so your big tip is make sure the buy button is working. You skipped the logo, the name, this and that. Let's just make sure the buy button works.
So that's the buy button. Just make sure it's working and just kind of go through and do a test purchase and make sure it goes through. I didn't really focus on any of that. I just kind of focused on just getting a good-looking product and finding the right targeted audience.
Okay, so it was focusing on finding the right product and the right audience, and that kind of voices what Peter said almost exactly. And then Luda, let's talk about your story. You mentioned a little bit yesterday. I'm not sure who all heard it, but you spent, it might have been several months, if not even a whole year, working on getting the store perfect and getting everything right and getting everything looking. Your store was one of the best looking stores I've seen in a long time, but it wasn't making a huge amount of money. And then you quickly, in just like 2 weeks, launched another store. So one store took you months and months and months to build, and it didn't make money. And then 2 weeks later, you got a whole different store that's making money. So maybe you can relate to her question about the importance of that.
So you just have to make it also user-friendly. Easier to navigate. For instance, I had some products have like 5, 6, sometimes 11 variants, and they're all, you go in, and in order to see all the variants, you just have to scroll. There's a way to, so what I did is I added a slider, and all you do is just press the button, and it, you know, it's like a carousel type of slider. So you're able to view the variants. And as long as it's user friendly and easy to navigate, it doesn't have to be the most prettiest store.
Okay, so variants. So when you're talking about a product has variants, because some people here maybe at a beginner level and not even know what that means, an example of a variant, maybe you'll give some examples, might be a product color. Might have more than one color,
mm-hmm.
or more than, what are some examples?
Style.
Of more than one style. Mm-hmm. So an example would be, if I'm selling a t-shirt, I might have a t-shirt and a hoodie. That would be a variant of that. And then maybe I have both in black and then both in red. So you'd want people to be able to scroll through and see the pictures. But it might, by default, it might be this long scrolling page that's difficult. You found with Shopify an easy way to just add in a slider.
Yep.
And do they need to know, like, advanced PHP programming?
No, what I did was I actually switched themes. I had a theme that didn't offer the slider. And I'm sure there's a way to go in and add code and do it, but I just switched themes.
So for the advanced people that know how to code, Shopify does allow you to be able to throw in some code and do almost anything you want. Mm-hmm. If you're the Chase Bauer type, he's like, why would you need a new theme? You just put in this JavaScript, jQuery, syncing back to the database, whipping back around, it goes to the... And Luda's like, I'll just change themes. This one has a slider on
and
it.
And what they'll do is they'll give you, Shopify will give you an hour of like, of coding, of what they can do to customize your site. And if it's too cumbersome, they'll just... They won't do it, but it's you have 1 hour. So if you want to change your like navigation or whatnot, if you want to change the interface, not the interface, but certain things on your website, they'll take 1 hour to do that and do it for you.
So explain that. So if somebody has their website almost the way they want it, but they wanted a change,
right.
What you're saying is they can contact Shopify, mm-hmm. and Shopify will actually help them design their site if it's pretty basic.
Yeah, so if you want like a security logo or something, you don't know how to code. Just let them know and they'll do it.
So you can literally say like, wow, I want like a secure site logo or whatever like this other site has, but I don't know how to do it. You can literally contact Shopify, and as long as it's simple, they'll actually do it for you. Who thinks that's pretty cool? Right?
Can we go back to the apps recommendation?
Yeah.
So I would highly recommend the Shopify app. It's basically an automated system. You import products, and then the order fulfillment process is seamless. So just a few days ago, I had a customer that had...
Would you recommend that too?
That had ordered 11 different variants of the same product, and I used different vendors, three or four different vendors. So for me to fulfill, to place 11 different orders would have taken, I don't know, 15 minutes maybe, because you have to go in and you have to select the variant, enter in the address, the shipping information, the name, and all you do is just pretty much press a button and it auto-populates all the information.
Nice. And Chase, maybe at a time in the future, like I asked Lawrence if he'd be willing to do maybe a shipping thing, at a time in the future, would you be open to an interview if I wanted to maybe find out how people in the community could do some of the one-click stuff you've been able to do, your little wizardry? Would you be open to doing a webinar for everybody? Would you guys like Chase to show you the side of one-click stuff? Okay. Let's do this. I'm going to switch up this panel a little bit. Chase actually has to jump on a flight and has to leave. Good thing he stayed for that part, though. He's bad for that. He wanted to stay for the plug for that. Chase is going to leave. I'm going to go ahead and take his seat on the panel, but before we do, Chase has been a big contributor in the community. He's helped us out a lot. Can we give him a hand? Here's a parting gift. All right, dude. Take care. Thank you. All right, let's keep it going. Where's the next question? Is it Alicia over there in the back? Let's take another question.
Hey, what's up, guys? It's Pow Pow. Really quickly, I had just a question. I wanted to increase up my game on tracking, and I realized that when I look at my Facebook ads, like let's say I'm running a free plus shipping offer, it doesn't calculate the shipping dollars that I'm making. And also, when I'm running a retail offer, it'll calculate the money that they made, but it doesn't calculate the shipping. And sometimes I increase the shipping to make a little bit more profit. So is there a way to start tracking and being able to do that?
Okay, there is. One of the best guys to answer that question just walked out. But we're going to do a webinar on that. But if anybody wants to chime in, we'll do something on that specific issue, because I know you're a little bit further along than some people might be. But Peter grabbed the mic, so maybe you have a response to that?
Yeah, I was just going to say, Chase gave me like a little code that I didn't know what it was, but he just told me where to put it on my store. And then I started seeing shipping on all my Facebook ads, the shipping pricing with the retail pricing. So but he just left. So.
Well, here, just on a side note on that, Chase agreed to do a webinar. Chase is a little ninja with his little codes, and he can create little stuff for us. Plus, Techademics will gladly put some time into creating stuff that makes life easier. If you guys notice problems, let us know. But Chase will do a webinar with us, and I'm sure Chase will be willing to help out with that code like he did with Peter. Do you have a follow-up?
Just a quick follow. Oh, there we go. Hey, Peter, if I buy you a drink, can you give me that code?
Because when you copy and paste the code in, I don't know what the code is. You know, I would have to probably find his actual message that he sent to me and like scroll up, because you know when you copy and paste something in, it's all mixed in with the code. So I don't even remember where he told me to put it. Like, it's really tactical stuff. I didn't know what he was talking about.
It's left bracket question mark semicolon squiggly line. Okay. We'll have to do, he does do top shelf vodka, he'll get that to you. Get him drunk enough, he'll suddenly remember.
I'll send it to you though, if I can find
Where's
it.
The other? Okay, we're back here, Phil.
Hi, I'm Ileana from San Diego, and I fear I might be too late for this question because I've been meaning to ask it all weekend, which has to do with the plugin that shows you the e-packet on when on AliExpress. How do you see it with the price plus the e-packet on there, and then also the one-click add to your Shopify store from AliExpress?
Great question. Again, yeah, that question is a little bit too late. I'm sitting in the seat of the developer of that application, Chase. Chase had to catch a flight because he has to get back home and develop some more cool stuff. So, we're going to do a webinar on showing how to do that. And I'm sure with the bulk buying power of Techademics and the community we represent, I'm sure Chase will also do something pretty cool for us to make sure that we have some resources like that. I know Lowell's also developed some, both Lowell and Chase have developed some pretty awesome communities that, tools that I've been, you know, using with Shopify for the last year or so. Lowell has some great research tools. Chase has some great one-click tools. So if you're ever wondering when I do demos how it shows the cost of ePacket, Chase developed that kind of stuff. And again, we have a great development team at Techademics as well, so we'll gladly develop that. So yeah, that question's maybe 5 minutes too late. I could probably get a webinar, I will say, the week after Thanksgiving is probably a likely time that I can do that. Maybe even on the Ecom Power team, one of maybe the first several episodes, maybe you can get on with Chase and walk through that as well. Let's go to this side of the room somewhere. I can't see, so just go for it.
Hey, this is Lee from California. Just wanted to ask, I heard Peter touch briefly on Instagram and Pinterest, and then Luda was touching on Instagram. Is there any, like, the second choice any of you would make besides Facebook? I know Facebook is a pretty popular. And also, I was wondering if you do find a winning ad, what is the rate that you would normally suggest that you would scale up as far as, you know, do you go from $5 to $10, or, you know, what would be the graduation for that?
Okay, so two totally different questions. You want to take the first one first?
Yeah, sure. So one thing, and that's awesome that Luda's doing really well with Instagram, but I wouldn't encourage you to go and sway into other platforms yet. If you guys can figure out Facebook, you can pretty much understand every other platform. I mean, we could talk about, I know lots of guys on Pinterest that are doing, you know, $10,000 to $15,000 a day, you know, but don't get excited about those. There's like unlimited of what you can do on Facebook, right? And it's very easy to tie in with Instagram using the Facebook platform. But for a second one, for us, I mean, we're really heavy with retargeting. You know, even with how someone was saying, you know, when do we shut it off? And sort of like the stock market. But sometimes I find out when we're optimizing that we'll actually lose money on an ad if you calculate how much you're making with your retargeting because of that initial ad, right? Hopefully that makes sense, but let's just use that $5 value. But maybe it took you $5 to get a conversion, and you know, with retargeting though, it can totally change that whole variable. So you can start scaling quite a bit more. So
okay, so for the first part, you were saying yes, there's lots of other ways to advertise on social media, but stay in your lane, master paid traffic with Facebook, and then you'll easily be able to master the other platforms.
That's what I'd suggest first, especially for the kind of stuff that, you know, you're hearing people how they're scaling their business and stuff. Like, we've done extremely well on Facebook. We are on some other platforms, but Facebook is still king at this time anyway, so.
Okay, so master Facebook first. And the second part, for scaling, you said one of the nice ways to scale is through retargeting ads. Because you can go and you can retarget back to those customers. You can retarget more of your products to those customers that already bought. You can retarget people that visited and didn't buy. There's a lot of retargeting. So for scaling, retargeting. Let me ask you a follow-up question. Maybe anybody else that wants to jump on this one. Let's say you have a $5 per day, and I think that might have even been what the question was. Let's say you have a small ad, $5, $10 per day, whatever it is, a small dollar amount per day. If that ad's working, do you just increase the amount from like $5 a day to $100 a day on that ad, on that campaign? Or do you duplicate it out to several $5 a day ads? Or do you go up a little bit? Like, when it comes to scaling, you're like, hey, I'm willing to throw $100 a day at this. What's the best way?
No, that's a great question. So in the old days, you could just start upping that budget. You know, you could do it daily or sometimes twice a day or whatever. I wouldn't encourage you doing that. So if anything, I would start breaking it out and actually start optimizing your ads. So if you're seeing, you know, certain states or countries or wherever you're targeting, age, genre, I mean, you can go on and on sort of thing. But we slowly break it out and we start pulling where those metrics are coming from, and then we duplicate that ad set and just scale from there. So, and what I mean by scale, like some of our products will have, you know, up to 3,000 different ad sets. All with a budget of, you know, $5 to $10 a day. So,
okay, and that's extreme scaling. So we, you know, obviously,
but just showing
you
how much you can go with it.
So what he's talking about is a concept I talked about a long time ago too, and it's a concept a lot of people here probably share. Instead of scaling up, you scale out. Okay, so what happens when you have a successful ad? Instead of scaling up, saying I'm going to jump from $5 to $100, look at the ad and look at the data and say, okay, Who's buying? Maybe it's just as simple as duplicate the ad and do it just to men, duplicate the ad and do it just to women, and then you start to get some data. Or maybe duplicate the ad into different age groups. So instead of one $5 a day ad, maybe you have a $5 a day ad to the general audience, then another $5 a day ad to 35 to 55, another one to 25 to 35, and then maybe by country. You know, maybe you got one to the United States, one to Canada, or maybe by state. You know, I remember when I started selling on Teespring, I actually ran, I did a shirt that was to the audience of the San Francisco 49ers. My first ad, it was a commemorative shirt that I thought they would like. My first ad was just to the whole audience, San Francisco 49ers on Facebook. Believe it or not, that was selling like crazy. I didn't do anything. I was a beginner. I just chose San Francisco 49ers, like 20 million people. Then I was like, this is working. Instead of scaling up, I did the same exact ad, but instead of all San Francisco 49ers, I did San Francisco 49er fans in California was one ad. And then in Texas was another ad. And then in Arizona was another ad. Believe it or not, even though the 49ers are based out of San Francisco, there was fans all over the United States. And actually, some of those states converted better than even California, because a 49er fan living in Texas is very, very loyal and hardcore being that. And then I even started doing it by city. I started segmenting small $5 a day ads to San Francisco, to Oakland, to Sacramento, to San Jose, to San Diego, to Los Angeles. I broke out like 8 different cities inside of California. Each was their own ad. So I could have just taken the ad and gone up to like $200 a day. But when you scale up, for whatever reason, Facebook kind of diminishes those results a little bit. It's weird. You would think they would reward you for spending more money. They seem to punish you. But when I set out these $5 a day ads scaled out, each ad was performing pretty much as good as the original. And if they're not, it's really easy. You can cut these little $5 a day ads. That's why I like the $5 per day system. Even though we don't all use, probably don't all use it, maybe we do, but we might not all use that same system. I've always liked it because it's easy to do and easy to teach. So scale out instead of scaling up. Does anybody have any more follow-up questions on scaling or scaling tips?
Well, yeah, like you said, in last year, the scaling up the budget was working very well. You can adjust the budget daily, I mean, several times a day. But right now, I talked to one of my Facebook contacts a couple of weeks ago, and she suggested that you can raise the budget once a day with no more than 20% for the ad set, up to, I mean, as long as you're seeing an increase in conversion, and so, of course.
Okay, so a little tip coming from a Facebook ads rep that says if you want to scale up your budget, don't scale it any more than 20% at a time. So take whatever your budget is and only scale it 20% at a time.
Yeah, and no more than once a day, and even let it run, maybe wait every other day, because just to let the ad optimize before you up the budget again.
Okay, so again, where people make the mistake is they think scaling fast. Oh my God, if this is doubling my money at $5, I want to double my money at $100 or $1,000. It's what we all think. When you get a winner, you're like, who wouldn't want to, this is getting triple the money, who wouldn't want to take $10,000 and throw it on that tripler? But it doesn't work that easy, or we would all be very, very wealthy. $14,000 or $15,000 a day would be the smallest anybody would be doing. So you have to scale up with patience. Like every other day, kind of keep increasing the budget, or scale out. I've had more success scaling out because you can go very rapidly. You want a new question, or anybody want to jump on it? New question from there.
My name is Trevor Tolan, and I'm with Team Bora Bora.
How old are you?
I'm 11.
11, well. Wow.
How do you handle returns and chargebacks?
Ooh, man, I didn't learn about that till I was in my 30s. Returns and chargebacks. Do we have anybody brave enough to weather that storm?
Yeah, first of all, I haven't had that many returns of my free plus shipping items. Maybe, I mean, it's less than 10 out of 30,000 orders.
Well, hold on, so far, out of 30,000 orders, you've only had 10 returns?
10 returns. Well, I've had refunds, but not returns.
Okay, so returns he hasn't as much of. Not saying you won't, but he hasn't. 30,000 products sold, only 10 actually returned. Okay, refunds.
Yeah, refunds, well, first to talk about returns. If they want to return the item, I'll let them return the item to me, but I have them shipping it to me, to my office in California, not back to China, so that I can resell the item if I want to. And they pay for the shipping back to me if they want to do that.
Okay.
And refund if they are, I mean, if they're complaining about the item and want a refund, I usually give them to them and let them keep the item if they're not happy. I want a happy customer. So. And I'm losing $10, but I mean, yeah.
Okay, so I think what I hear you saying is, yes, there's going to be some losses, $10 here, $10 there, through this process. But you're only really getting those losses if you're selling a lot and you just kind of eat it. You just kind of eat the cost.
Yeah. It's not a big cost for me when I'm selling, getting thousands of orders a month. So my refund rate is less than 1%. So yeah.
Okay, so returns are minimal, really minimal, and refunds are less than 1%. So on a basic level, so nobody has to get crazy about it, keep the customer happy, eat the cost, eat the cost of it, as long as you're selling low price. Now, if it was a product in the hundreds of dollars, maybe you'd rethink it. But keep as long as it's only a small percentage of it, just eat the cost and keep moving forward.
Yeah, correct.
Okay, does anybody else want to chime in on this?
I also want to add, when it comes to chargebacks, that he asked about that. So I've had maybe a couple of chargebacks per month coming in, so maybe one out of 5,000 orders or something like that. What I do, I try to contact the customer first and see. Usually when they're filing a chargeback, they're saying it's a fraudulent order, someone ordered this, and it wasn't authorized by me, you know. So I try to contact the customer, send them an email, and tell them, hey, we saw that you filed with your bank a chargeback. So for your order here, we wanted to just make sure that if this is correct, I mean, if this was a fraudulent order or not. And sometimes I also usually tell them that we want to help you solve this fraud. So we want to cooperate with the police. We're going to take the IP address that that was used with placing the order with your card. So to give it to the police, we want to help you with that. So, and then they usually contact me back and say that, well, I'm sorry, it was my son that ordered this, and they used my card. I didn't know about it, so I'm sorry. I'll just let they withdraw it.
Okay, so in a nutshell, that's kind of funny. In a nutshell, when you do get chargebacks, you can fight them, debate them, and then a lot of times they might just clarify, oh, I didn't know I won. So when you're actually filling out your billing details, you can make sure you have a decent company name that has to do with your store and not that company name that you had. Funny. Yeah, he got a lot of chargebacks because the name he was using. It's like the name he was using, man, I can't believe you did that. And you still made, what, six figures with that store? You made six figures with a store name that I'm afraid to say in front of a live audience. And they got it on their billing report that they got it from this vulgar store name. And he still got some chargebacks from it. Did you ever end up changing the name to something a little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you edit the store name in the billing, that will help with chargebacks. A lot of times, when I talk to people, a lot of times chargebacks, they actually just think that it's an unrecognizable charge. Like, I didn't spend that, and they fight it. Also, you can prevent chargebacks by being responsive in customer support. If they contact you and you're not responsive, their next thing is a chargeback. You know, I didn't do this. So any other advice for refunds, returns, chargebacks?
Yeah, you know what? If you mimic another company that's doing very, very well at this, and I'm sure a lot of you have heard of Costco.
Costco. Right?
Costco is amazing at this because it's like a silent salesman going on all the time where, you know, you don't know when the item's going to run out. But if you do buy it, you can always return it, right? And they, it's just a numbers game, right? There is going to be a certain amount of people that are just going to do a refund or they're just going to be a pain or whatever. You know, if you just bank that into your numbers sort of thing, you know, we do something similar. We'll just give them their money back. I mean, obviously, we'll try to help them or maybe get them to do a picture or something. But it is all about a customer experience. If you're really building a brand and not just going to have this one store wonder sort of thing, you want to take care of your customers. Because if it's amazing what has happened when we do take care of people like that. And sometimes we'll even give them an extra, you know, credit for, you know, sort for the hassle. They'll use that, and they'll, if you look at their average order value, it goes up significantly. Like, they just felt like you just treated them extremely well, and you know, they felt confident and comfortable shopping at your store. So
awesome. So again, if you're building up, a lot of us, as you're starting to build up a brand, if you envision your store selling thousands and thousands of customers, then build a brand and treat your customers right, and then they might even come back and do more. Okay, so keep that in mind if you're building a long-term brand. Treat your customers right. It's a good habit to be in. That's what a lot of stores do. And I also heard you say, if you're putting together projections for your store, man, I want to sell this much, I want to do this much. Hey, also put in the, you know, I'm going to expect that there might be 1% of people that refund, you know, that I got to do. Let's just eat that. Put that in your numbers. If you're a planner, factor it. There's no way you're going to have 100% success ratio.
Yeah, so what I do, like, this is what I do. You don't have to do it. It's a little more advanced, but there's pretty much two types of unsatisfied customers, right? It's either your fault or their fault, okay? It's either your vendors messed up or they messed up. Me personally, and again, you guys don't have to do this, but my store, I always make sure that I put a 30-day money-back guarantee, okay? If they don't like it, that's fine. We'll give them their money back, but I'll teach you how to combat that in a second, okay? Because the reason why I offer that is obviously because the conversion rates is going to increase, and I don't want, if they're not, you know, I'm not trying to take their money, I'm trying to serve them, right? So if they buy the product, and they complain about it and they want a refund, what I do is I ask them to send us a picture if it's broken, or send us a picture that the print sucks, right, or something, okay? If it's verified that it's our fault, right, then we always usually just give the refund. It's our fault, right? Or we contact the vendor and have the vendor pay us back too, and then we pay them. If it's their fault and they just don't like it, then what I taught my support team to do is, first, you offer them, you can keep the product, but we're going to give you a coupon code for 20% off. Hopefully, they'll be happy. If they still complain, then we're going to give you a coupon code for 20% off, and we'll give you a partial refund for 20%, and you can keep the product. So you're going to get money back, you're going to get a discount on the next order, and you get to keep the product. If they still complain and it's still within 30 days, then we're just going to refund them, and they get to keep the product. Right, and they still get the 20% off, and the they don't need a partial refund; they're getting a full one, right? But hopefully, they still buy again because now they have 20% off. Okay, so
no, okay,
so it's speed too.
Let's talk about that real quick. I want to just chime in on that and then chime in. So, if I have 100 customers that want to refund something, statistically, if I say, "Hey, you know what? Instead of a refund, let me give you this other benefit for free," statistically, a percentage of them will accept it. Yes. So right off the bat, there's not a bad practice here. That's a nice practice. Instead of completely giving a refund, statistically, a percentage of them will take an alternative deal if you offer one. You got really creative and came up with one. Then after that's all said and done, then you can offer a refund. And then also, if it's the vendor's problem, you're saying there might be a way to work directly with the vendor so you don't have to eat the cost.
Yeah.
Those are two very good tips.
Yeah, just I was going to say speed, too, right? People, they want a response, like, right away. So if, like, we have a customer service team as well, so they work very, very quickly. But, yeah, it's just people feel like they're taken care of, even if it's not the answer they want, as long as they're getting an answer. If you let them stew, it steams into something that it doesn't have to be. So
exactly. Like maybe just a misunderstanding can turn into a chargeback where they're saying you're a fraudulent company or whatever, and a bunch of chargebacks can maybe PayPal or whoever might shut down your account because they didn't want to see those chargebacks. And you're thinking, wait, I'm doing a legitimate business. And a lot of the time, that just has to do with a lack of speed in your support department.
Exactly. Yeah, you brought up like PayPal. You got to be careful if you're scaling fast and you have a lot of money going through that account. You need to take care of customers like super fast and have answers. Because if you are doing those kind of numbers and they freeze your account, it's a real pain to get, you know, a lot of money. It sometimes takes like 6 months to get back. So be careful with that. It's just customer, they want you to take care of their customers as well, right? So
exactly. And PayPal, I'll do another training on this. I already have one in the 8K per day formula modules. I think those modules, even I think in the free members area, I have some of those in Techademics. But PayPal will actually give you something called a working capital loan for your business. If you're doing enough transactions with PayPal and they see a consistent amount of money, they'll loan you money. I mean, PayPal, when I was starting up my business, no credit check. You could have a 500 credit score. No credit check whatsoever. If you're doing a successful amount of e-commerce using PayPal and there's not a lot of chargebacks, they look at your account. After 90 days, you have a track record with PayPal. They'll loan you money. They were giving me $50,000 at a time. And then you pay it back through your money coming into PayPal. And you can choose that 10% of your money coming in just goes to pay back the loan. They have a really cool system with no credit required. Just get a track record. That whole entire track record is gone if you have slow support and people do chargebacks. Even if it's not your fault, it kind of is your fault if it was a slow support issue. So does anybody here have any Do you sit around all day answering support tickets yourself for your business? I mean, what's a good idea for people to do support?
No, not at all. We have a whole team that does this, so we just
You didn't start with a whole team though.
That's right. That's
so,
right.
So is it easy for somebody to hire somebody to help them with support? Do they have to? Is this something where everybody's gonna have to sit around their computer all day waiting for a support ticket to come in so they can answer back?
Yeah, no, it's really easy actually. You can easily hire someone, even foreign or whatever, that it can be super affordable. You know, it's fast. You can train them. Like, we always have KPIs in our company and stuff, so it's very easy to track if they're going to be successful or not right out of the gates. So,
awesome. And does anybody here do you do all your support yourself? Do you recommend they do some support themselves, outsource some? What's your thoughts on support?
Yeah. So when I first started, I did all the support myself, and I was going nuts. Like, I would work all day, and I got nothing done. I'm just answering support tickets. Eventually, what happened was, you go on Upwork, the same way you would find a designer is the same way you would find a support helper, right? A support VA.
Real quick, you said it fast. Upwork. Yes. That's a website that people can go to find support people.
Yes. Upwork.com.
Up, like the word up? Yeah. And the word work, like you're working a job. UPWORK.com. What Peter said was the same way you could find the designer for graphics there, you could also find support people. Sounds like you found some support people on Upwork.com.
Yeah, so you just go on Upwork, you post a job saying I'm looking for someone to answer support tickets. And there should be a lot of people that already know that type of stuff, right? So what I did was, when I was still answering support tickets, in order to train my team how to do it, I just shot a video of myself answering the support ticket. Literally just my screen, and I'm talking, and I'm just answering it for them, like answering my own support tickets. And I would copy and paste the frequently asked questions and the frequently answered questions, like just my answers, right? And I put it all in a file. I gave them the video, and I gave them the file, like to my team, the people I'm hiring. They see the video, they see the file, and they start knowing what to do right away.
You guys, that's a very powerful lesson right there. Listen, they deserve an applause. So you can do this yourself, okay? In the beginning, do some of the customer support yourself so that you get familiar with that process. You can't properly delegate a task unless you're at least familiar with the task. Do some of the support yourself, and then record your screen of you going through and answering tickets. Take that screen recording, and when you hire a new support person, say, watch this video, help me if you have any questions, and then turn over support to them. Now, instead of you responding to all the tickets, now you're more overseeing somebody else responding, making sure they get the hang of it. Eventually, you get somebody well-trained. You don't even really have to oversee it. You just kind of know it's going well. You pop in there every once in a while. Delegation, that's what it sounded like in the beginning. You went crazy doing all the support yourself. And in hindsight, that's something you would have definitely outsourced sooner,
yeah.
Right? Same thing, would you say, Lawrence, same thing? I mean, anybody else here? You handle your support in the beginning. By the way, 11 years old, is that a pretty sharp question for an 11-year-old to ask? Question.
Hi, actually, the young lad asked the question I was gonna ask. But to take that a step further, is there a process within our back office in Shopify or somewhere that we click in billing or whatever, that you can refund that money back to whatever credit card, debit card, or whatever they used? How are we giving the money back?
Does anybody here want to handle the question of how do they process refunds in their Shopify store? Luda?
So for each product, there is a refund button, and you just... Each order. You just refund whichever order they want a refund for.
Well, let's dive into it just a little bit. I mean, it literally is that simple. When you go into your orders, there's a button to refund right there. But where does the money come from? Is the money drawing out of your bank? I mean, where's the money coming from?
So wherever it came from, if it came from PayPal, it'll go back to their PayPal account. If it was Shopify payments or Amazon, whichever payment method they use is where it will be applied.
Awesome. So literally, Shopify makes it so simple.
Yeah.
You look up the customer order number. They say they want a refund. You find it. You literally push a button. It's handled. You don't have to worry about anything on your
side.
It's
very easy.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to chime in?
Also, that whole process of going to the order and clicking the refund, you can also do the partial refund on that too. And you can shoot a video of yourself doing that and give that to your support VA. And that's how they learn how to do it.
So go through it when you have refunds, do a couple yourself, and if you want to offer that partial refund thing, you can teach your support how to ask them if they're okay with a partial refund and a coupon to buy something else. And if they accept that, you can teach them how to go in and do a partial refund or a full refund. Next thing you know, it's one less task you got to worry about, so you could focus on just checking your ads every 3 days and doing $15,000 a day. Question behind me? I don't know where. Well, no, only where the mic is. Over here.
Yeah, I found a really neat trick. A couple of people asked me, how should I write my ads? Should I make them bold? Like, you know, I don't know what to write. So what I do is, well, I can't take credit for this. I saw it online. All you have to do is go to, like, Facebook and like fan pages of, let's say, fishing gear, and just like that page. And then what you'll see is, in your news feed, you'll see all these ads popping up on, you know, fishing stuff. Just a little neat trick, and, you know.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's a phenomenal question. No, just kidding. real quick, since you got the mic, can you share the quick, can you share like a quick little 30-second testimonial? How long ago did you start your Shopify store? Is it getting sales? Maybe a 30-second testimonial?
Yeah, I just started Shopify like 2 weeks ago, and I'm already making sales. Like, I've made like 6K in like 2 weeks.
Nice. So it's pretty cool. And as that store continues to grow, keep sharing that testimonial. I'd love to hear more about it. I know you already shared it all with me and showed it to me. Pretty phenomenal that you're doing that. Great tip. Like other fan pages, and you can actually start seeing the ads that other people place in your newsfeed in that niche. Pretty cool idea. Let's go here with a question.
Hi, my name is McKenna, and I was curious, if you could start all over again, what was one thing you would do different from the start?
Nice. And McKenna, how old are you?
13.
Gosh, this could be a long list of things we'd do different. If anybody wants to take a stab, if you could start over, put yourself in their shoes, what's something, at least something, that you would do differently, knowing what you know now?
Okay, I'll take this one, or try. But I would have done a lot of things differently, for sure. But definitely, I would have structured things a lot more for the build, right? So, I mean, I'm a marketer, so I grow things very, very quickly. But I get punished for doing that sometimes. I think I would have just structured my team better. You know, like we're all talking about these different roles, and as you scale, you can't physically do all of these things yourself. So it's always good to know, or at least plan for what it could be or where you're going to go, right? So anyways, this is one trick that I learned a long time ago that I wish that I would have learned it earlier in my business days. And that's just structuring each employee based on like a KPI. Do you guys know what KPIs are?
Some. Okay. You might as well explain it.
All right. So you guys want to hear just an example of how I did this? Do I got time to do this real quick?
Yep.
Okay. Okay. So KPIs called key performance indicators.
Key right? performance indicator, KPI.
Okay, so it's basically, it's just a measure of what you want that employee to do. So as an example, I was actually explaining this to somebody else here just earlier or yesterday, but they said, you know, do you have a team of media buyers? And I'm like, yeah, we do. And they're like, well, how do you ever hire someone that could possibly do media buying? And you're right, that's a hard question, because if you hire like a media buyer, everybody tells you exactly what you want to hear in an interview process, right? It's like, oh yeah, I'm really good at it, you know, I'm amazing. But they're usually not. In fact, they fail you almost every time that you try something. So I wanted to fast forward that instead of just having them on our payroll. And we implemented this thing called KPIs. And what it is that we're making them accountable, right? So I make them own whatever they say that they can do. So for example, if we have an ad that's already running and it's doing, you know, X amount of conversions, like let's say it's doing 50 conversions a week, right? I ask them, I'm like, what do you think that you could do? I mean, we're already doing 50 a week anyway, so what are you going to do that's better than what we're doing? I mean, we've got a lot of ads, what can you do? And they're like, well, I could easily do another 30, you know, conversions a week, no problem. I'm like, okay, awesome. So for sure, you could do another 30, you know, no problem. At the end of this week, when we're talking, you know, you'll have an extra 30 in addition. Yeah. So, and then what you do, so you get them to own it a little bit, right? Then you check in halfway through the week, and you're like, hey, man, you know, I'm just going through some stuff. And I noticed not a whole lot of stuff is happening yet. Like, what's going on? And they're like, oh, you know what? It's, you know, I'm getting there. And they'll give you what's called, like,
blame, excuses, or denial. Okay, and this is pretty normal. This is just a normal thing. And they'll be like, oh, you know, if only I had this tool, you know, that's all I need. If I had this little tool thing, it'll make it really easy, and I'll be able to get that 30 by the end of the week. I'm like, okay, so that's the only thing you need. So if I get this tool for you, you can get that extra 30 conversions, you know, just by having this tool. I just want to make sure that's all, because I don't want to have a conversation at the end of the week with you, and you said that you also needed another tool, right? So And what I'm doing is I'm getting them to own it, okay? That's all it is. And I want to fast forward this. So two things will happen by the end of the week. They'll either they'll leave on their own, okay? Which I know it sounds funny, but I don't want to fire them, right? But I mean, I do if they're not going to do a good job. Or they're going to excel. They're going to do really well because they're accountable. They know I'm watching the numbers, and I'm basically I have a performance indicator, and I can do this in every single part of my company. And that's I know it sounds simple. It sounds like, oh, yeah, you know, but this is probably the biggest thing that I wish I would have implemented way sooner, because now I can manage a significant amount of people and I don't have to see, I can just look at their metrics. It's so easy, and that's how we pay them based on performance, you know, rewards, all that kind of stuff. It's all based on those numbers. So as we scale things, I can always check in, chime in, see exactly how they're doing.
Okay, so in a nutshell, for Lowell, and again, we're all in different places. Lowell's building a business that he wants to scale into the multiple eight figures, into tens of millions of dollars. Because of that, he's at a different phase than maybe somebody who's looking to make their first $1,000. He's in the phase of going back and saying, I wish I would have put together a better system to be able to scale this more effectively. What he said was this strategy called KPIs, which you can Google to learn more about. Each person that he brings on board, whether it's an outsource or whatever, find something to be able to measure them and measure their performance by. There's this old quote I know, where performance is measured, performance improves, right? So that's what you want to do. You want to find something to measure them by, make sure they own that measurement so they know what they got to do. If it was a salesperson, it's easy. Here's your benchmark.
Your goal. You can do this on anything, right?
Like we can do it with customer support.
Customer support, absolutely.
So like customer support, if you just let them work, they might spend all day answering 5 tickets. That might not be the performance you're looking for.
And it's being fair to them as well, because they might think that that's a good job, right? They don't know whatever that level is that you're doing. So
an example of a key performance indicator would be if Peter shows, hey, listen, I'm going to go slow, and I'm going to show you how I would respond to support with these things. In his video, Peter might take a 30-minute video, and in that 30-minute video, he might effectively respond to 10 customer support tickets and teach and train and go slow. Therefore, 20 an hour would be a reasonable pace. And he says, now listen, you're new, and even with this, 10 an hour might be good for you. So I'm going to hire you for 5 hours a day, whatever. That's 50 responses, good quality responses per day. He's just done his own, made it easier on them, went slow, so they don't have to be a superhero. He just created a performance indicator. Say, once you get that down, if you can do a better job and actually go through 100 per day, then I'll actually be willing to increase your what I'm paying you. You set these key performance indicators. If they meet these things, you can continue to increase benefits and perks and stuff like that for them and make them own it. And they'll get excited about it. There's some people out there that actually like a challenge rather than just doing a job for the sake of doing it.
Oh, for sure. They'll perform.
So some of you might not be there, though. Does anybody else have an answer to this question in terms of what's something you would do differently and maybe not to the level of scaling to an eight-figure business? What's something maybe that a beginner, if you were a beginner starting over right now, what's something you might do differently?
Well, I would have done the first day when I made my first sale, I would have started looking into how to hire virtual assistants to help me out with the fulfillment. Because at day 7, I had to pause my ads, and I had them paused for 4 days, and I lost a lot of sales revenue because of that.
Let's spend a minute or so, let's actually spend a little bit of time talking about this. Money comes in. When you say fulfillment, you mean sending that money to the vendor and sending in the order to the vendor and making sure they ship out. You're saying that is a time-consuming task that you wish you would have hired a virtual assistant to do a lot earlier for you.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't look into that until day 7. So, and it took me a few days to get them on board and get started. So
really day 10 or so before they started doing that.
Yeah.
So how many hours per day, roughly, were you spending doing that one task yourself?
I could probably fulfill 20 orders an hour. And Yeah, I had hundreds of orders coming in every day, 300 orders per day.
So you were spending all day.
Yeah, and I got some help from my wife and other friends and family, but it was like
this is important, okay? If somebody gets a product, it's the holidays. You started during the holidays. Hopefully, something starts selling well on your store. It might be wise, even as a beginner, as soon as they see that a product's selling and they understand the process, one of the very first things they might want to do is start looking at hiring a virtual assistant to help fulfill orders. That's one of the best things.
Yes, absolutely.
I think that's very, very important advice, you guys. Would you agree? Would you guys all agree? So without taking too long on it, and also after this, we'll just do one more question because I'm looking at the clock and I don't think we have a lot of time. Can you explain order fulfillment in a nutshell, the way you did it and then how you do to a customer? So money's coming into your site. You've got a picture of a product. You've got a title. You've got a description. You've got a price. Maybe you're selling it for free plus $9.95 shipping. So $9.95 comes to you. You've now made a sale. Let's just talk about even one sale. And that $9.95 comes to you, and you have the order information. Can you, in a nutshell, explain what do you do next? What do you do with that money and that customer information? How do you give it to the vendor, and how do you make sure that it gets shipped out properly?
Okay, yeah. So I go to AliExpress, and I take that money, and I go to the vendor that I have already chosen to work with, and I buy that item, whatever item it was, and variant that the customer selected, and enter their customer's shipping address into AliExpress. So basically, yeah, they're gonna ship it out directly. And then I also add a little note into the order saying that it's a drop shipping order, so I don't want the vendor to include any receipts or anything from them. It's to my customer, so.
Okay, so on a very simple level, with one product, you've collected money. You're essentially buying it like you would be buying it for your spouse. You're just putting in
Correct.
Their information, kind of like
Yes.
you'd be buying a Christmas gift for your spouse, and on a site it might say, do you want this to be as a present? You'd go, yes, I want it to show up as a present. Kind of similar, you would just order the product, you put in your spouse's information, the address, and in the notes, you're gonna put a little note that says, this is a drop shipping item, so don't show your branding or whatever. Make sure you send it like naked, what's equivalent
yeah,
to naked.
Yeah, correct. And then I have my credit card on file with AliExpress. I have that verified. That's something you need to do when you set up an AliExpress account. Pretty quickly, they will have you verify your account.
Okay, so when you go to AliExpress, and this is something we teach in our trainings, AliExpress is one wholesaling site, you set up an account, you add a credit card on file, and then you verify your credit card. They'll let a couple transactions go through, but if you ever want to do a lot of transactions, you need to have a verified account. They need to make sure you're not doing fraud. You verify your account, and then when you order, it'll just come off your credit card on file. So money's coming into your bank, and then you're going and you're placing orders for those customers. Let me take it one step further. And I know we don't have a whole lot of time, but one step further. Let's say you have 100 orders come in. Are you doing that exact process 100 individual times in a row?
Well, I'm using the app, but if I wouldn't have the app, then I mean, the one-click fulfillment app. So basically, to copy the customer information from Shopify into AliExpress in the same way that I would have done it manually.
Okay. So in the beginning, it's okay to do it manually if you have an order here, an order there. But once you start having several orders, there are apps. You're going to need to probably start investing in apps with either small fees or small monthly fees where you can, with one click, start copying and pasting information so it's faster. So if you have 1,000 orders in a day, you've got to basically order 1,000 individual products and have those sent out to all those places?
Well, 1,000 orders in a day, I would probably hire a virtual assistant, or I would do a bulk order contact the vendor with a spreadsheet with all the customer information, get the spreadsheet out of Shopify, and send the whole spreadsheet to this vendor so they ship it out.
Okay, so you can contact, one of the cool things with wholesale and dropshipping sites is you can contact the vendor, and you can say, hey, I'm starting to place a lot of orders, can I directly send you a spreadsheet with all the customer data on it so you could just ship it all out so I don't have to do this one at a time. And there are vendors that will work with you and will do this.
Yeah, some will do that, some won't. So if they don't want to do that and you can't find the item at any other vendor at that price, maybe you want to use the app anyway.
Okay, so in the beginning, all you're looking to do is just collect money. You're just a middleman. You're collecting money, and then you're placing the order on behalf of the customer. Believe it or not, it's a great way to make money. Okay? Then, as you start getting more orders, you're going to want to hire a virtual assistant to do that for you. If you're selling a lot of the same product, like you might have one necklace that's selling hundreds and hundreds per day, you might want to contact the vendor and say, hey, I'm selling hundreds and hundreds per day of this. Can I just send you a spreadsheet that of all the orders? And then you teach your virtual assistant to be able to work with them and do that. And then also when you're sending, when you're drop shipping, you can put notes in the order that says this is a drop shipping item. Most of them are actually pretty aware of that and know how to do that. So these are, I know it's very, very simple for a lot of you in here, but there might be some of you I wanted to really kind of talk through that a little bit slower. We don't mind showing you on webinars and stuff like that, but was there anybody in the room that at least that explanation helped give you a little bit more explanation here? Was that helpful? Does anybody else here want to add anything to that? Do you think did John give a good enough explanation? Does anybody have a technique? There are apps that can do this a little bit faster. Did you want to add something to that?
Yeah, so the same thing with answering support tickets. When I first had to do fulfillment, it was hell too, because I had to do fulfillment and support all day. So I did the same thing. I videotaped myself copying and pasting their address and their name and their info, and then I videotaped myself, you know, drop shipping the product to the customers, and I sent that to another VA, and then now I have two employees. That's how I did it.
So VA stands for virtual assistant. You found your virtual assistants at upwork.com. Where did you find your virtual assistants?
Yeah, I found mine, a couple of them at upwork.com, and also at a source called MrOutsource.com.
So a site called Mr. Outsource and upwork.com.
Well, yeah, Mr. Outsource, they were basically pre-screening the virtual assistants for me before, so they, know they were.
Got it.
Good.
Do you have virtual assistants?
Yes.
Here, let me hand the mic, since Lawrence hasn't talked to him. Do you have virtual assistants? How many do you have?
Yeah, so I have two virtual assistants. Same process. I started with one. They just were doing kind of, I kind of wrote down a list of tasks that I were doing on a day-to-day basis, and I kind of checked off the ones that I felt comfortable with delegating at first, and just kind of shot some videos, jumped on Skype with them, and kind of showed them the entire process.
Where did you find yours from?
I want to say Upwork as well. I jumped from Upwork.com and onlinejobs.ph.
Onlinejobs.ph is another resource. Upwork is formerly known as Odesk. If you're familiar with that, it's a new site, if you're wondering what that is. Now listen, I know these clocks say zero. The reason I'm going over for those of you in the back is I just feel like there's so much value here in this panel. I've been kind of just digging over this time a little bit. Are we cool if I do one more question in the back? You guys okay with that? I don't know where the mic is, who's next. We're going to do one back more question, and then we're going to wrap this panel up.
Name is Anthony Rudolph. So my question is, you guys just talked about video views and using that data to retarget to a segment that actually watched the videos. Are you guys using videos from YouTube randomly, or are you actually shooting those videos yourself? How are you finding those videos that you're using for the retargeting?
So I'll chime in, and then I think that would be good for you, Lawrence, since you just did an example. But if you're going to use other people's videos that you didn't do yourself, be cautious of copyright infringement, okay? For example, if you're watching a UFC fight, and somebody, Ronda Rousey's in a main fight with Holly Holm, and Holly Holm does this swinging kick and knocks her out, and it's the most unbelievable thing, and you want to target UFC fighters, it's a novel idea, but that footage is definitely going to be copyright protected by the Ultimate Fighting, by UFC. So you're using that at your own risk of your own business and your own everything, okay? And we would not ever encourage people to do that. You're your own entrepreneur. We would not encourage you to use copyright infringing stuff. So if you're going to use other people's stuff, have your own risk threshold of something that might be copyright infringed or protected or trademarked by somebody else, might have their stuff on it. And if you ever did say, hey, I'm going to use it anyways, or I'm going to use something anyways, make sure that you give people credit if you're using other people's stuff. That being said, there's also a lot of just go to watch it, turn on any news, and all the time they're showing people's videos, and people are using other people's videos all the time. So there's a way to do it. So yes, you can create your own. I showed you earlier how, and yes, you can use other people's videos. Have your own risk threshold, which is different for everybody. That being said, you've had some success with viral videos selling products. Can you explain two things? The process of what you did, and then What did that mean, people that watched over 10 seconds? Like, how did you find that data so that they know how to do that?
Yeah, so...
Hello?
Okay, yeah, so, yeah, with YouTube, there's actually a feature, like a filter, where you can check, and it's called Creative Commons, and you can actually, like, use those videos for free use. But, the example that I used yesterday with the Yankees, I actually used a... like a fan-made video that was just on YouTube, and it had like 200 views. No one used it, and I literally downloaded it, and I used it as my own. I've done videos where I've also just taken them directly from the Vine, vine.co. Like those are like little 10-second videos, and you can download those, and I've used those as well for ads. Jumping back, like with the Facebook makes the... Well, now they make several different audiences based on percentages of how much they watch of your video. So I think it's like 10%, 25%, 75%. So you can actually just go to your audience section in the ads manager, click create audience, go to custom audience, and then you can select the video and make your own audience based on that.
Okay, go to the audience section inside of your ads manager when you're running video ads. Facebook will automatically segment your audience based on how long they viewed the video, and you can create an audience from that group, okay? It's almost self-explanatory when you jump in there, but there might be a situation. You could also kind of Google it. Facebook is always going to change, so maybe 6 months from now, they'll probably even do it different. Like, I know when I wanted to advertise internationally on Facebook, I used to have to paste in a list of all the countries I wanted to advertise to, bulk locations. Now... like 2 weeks ago or a month ago, they just added a little button that says worldwide, and now you can advertise worldwide. Like, that's brand new. So Facebook will always be changing and making things easier. Facebook video ads has upgraded to where you go into your audience section, you can create an audience from people that have watched a certain length of that video. So again, use videos at your own risk threshold. Start running traffic to them with small little $5 a day ads targeting large audiences in the millions, and it'll narrow it down to a sub audience, and then you can retarget, create a custom audience from there, and advertise just to that audience. If you want more information specifically about how we're getting video views for 0.0001, I did a full day training for at least 6 hours on that topic alone inside of the Impact Series product that we sell here at Techademics. Log into Techademics, go to My Products, hit Impact Series. You can purchase that, and you can watch that session to learn more about that. Any final thoughts here on this?
Okay, here's a couple tricks for video, if you guys want. One is if you are finding a product on a platform like AliExpress, you can get it a lot faster through like Amazon or eBay. You can probably find the exact same product. Take that product. You literally don't have to be like an expert here. Like you can have like a ghetto video. Like seriously, this like take out your iPhone or your Android. You know, take whatever that product is. And take just a quick like 15-second video. Facebook will automatically duplicate that, so now you have a 30-second video, right? It's pretty easy. Like, don't overthink this. Make it look like it was shared in Facebook. Like, literally, make it look like it's like sometimes when you make it too smooth and too good, it doesn't convert as well, right? It's a social network, so you sort of want to have that same sort of thing.
Yeah, so, like a little bit more raw and authentic absolutely. And real. Versus yeah. looking like an advertisement.
Exactly.
Nobody wants to see ads. When you go on TV and you're watching a show, you hate the commercial breaks. You'd rather the show run straight through. But if in the show there was product placement of stuff, you don't mind. You're seeing the same advertisement, but you don't mind because you're still seeing the show. You want to keep it native to the platform. You want to keep your experience real and authentic for your people.
Absolutely.
It's a good trick for video ads.
Yeah, so for video ads, for me, what I've done and what I've seen a lot of people do is because me, I do a lot of t-shirts, is I would just get a picture of the shirt, like let's say it's black, and then it would be kind of like a screen show, like a slide. It'd be black, and then I would show them the red shirt, a hoodie, a green shirt, and it would just be like a 10-second video of like different colors and different hoodies and maybe a mug, and then on the link, it'll just say like available in mugs, available in red or a hoodie, and then that's just how I make the video. It's really easy to do. It's literally like a PowerPoint.
Simple, raw videos. It's a great way to be able to do this. So.